Musk indicated that the Tesla semi was able to offer $101.26 per mile, while the average regular diesel semi was running at a cost rate of $151. So as part of reviewing his comments, I went and looked up on Google what the real cost was per mile that truckers were experiencing, and I was surprised to find out that that number is actually $1.38. So today we kind of review that difference in number one, and number two, how that impacts Tesla. This is Greg for Tesla Fan Insight. Strasviche, ni hao ma, bonjour. Thanks for taking time out once again to spend some time with us. Today's talk focuses on the price gap or savings gap that Tesla experiences that benefits truckers or trucking companies that are involved mostly in the shipping space, obviously. So I chose to do this talk today because I was kind of surprised to learn Elon Musk had described the fact that the $1.26 per mile cost of operation for a Tesla truck was a much better situation than the $1.56 or $1.51 per mile experienced by the average diesel truck. So as I was reviewing this, I was kind of stunned to find out that the real number is 138. And so 138 to 126 is approximately a 10% savings. And at current, electricity isn't being, there are no taxes on the electricity. So the fuel taxes experienced by truckers is actually a tax not paid on electricity currently, but I think there'll be some road taxes that once electric big trucks get going will be charged and could further close the gap between the two. So as I was looking through this, I was starting to wonder whether or not the advantages that I sort of inherently thought were there for the electric semis really were there. Another sort of data point that popped to mind was the fact that one of the big reasons for the shift from diesel to electric that cost-wise made sense was the fact that a diesel truck gets 5 to 6 miles per gallon on average, while particularly the Tesla truck is rolling at about 20 miles per gallon. So with 3 times the mileage, I thought there'd be a windfall of sort of proceeds from this, but the problem you run into is that the percentage of overall cost that are experienced relative to fuel is sort of second only to labor. So that I thought was pretty amazing, interesting, that yes, fuel is an issue, yes, the electric truck has an impact on what people are doing, but it's not as substantive an issue as one might have thought. Another factor that sort of jumps off the page is the fact that when you look at the list of expenses, and we'll put those very briefly at the front of the talk and then, you know, a longer look at the end of the talk so you can sort of look through what the numbers are. I was kind of fascinated because there's repairs and there's maintenance. Elon Musk has stated that for the first 1,000,000 miles, there'll be no maintenance on a Tesla truck. And obviously that's a savings on a per mile basis, so it starts to push the gap between the two vehicles in terms of cost the other way. Now, I have to admit that for me, that the cost numbers that really jumped off the page was illustrated here in, you know, sort of the items that I highlighted. I'd like to suggest that, you know, there may be other elements of this that some of the truckers that are part of our viewership may want to suggest are variables in the thinking process. You know, for now, one of the big issues for Tesla is that in terms of the heaviest loads of trucking, there are large areas of, for example, Los Angeles and other places where pollution is a huge issue with the semi-trucks that are working in those areas. And because Tesla is the only long-distance option that people have, I think there's a pretty large market for the trucks as is. And to my knowledge, they're sold out for the first couple to 3 years of production that they're going to be having. But this starts to raise the question of, hey, wait a second, if the gap is only 10%, is that enough to really make a big deal about sort of the value proposition that's represented by going to electric if there are some other headaches that sort of go along with it? So I was kind of fascinated by sort of looking through the numbers and understanding fully what was going on there, because yes, things are good. Yes, there's great reasons to go. Yes, there's pollution reasons to go. But sort of, is that enough? One other sort of repair angle that comes to mind as well relative to electric is just the fact that as you move downhill, there's a lot of brake pad destruction that goes on with trucks on the backside of those hills, and the regenerative braking is one of the ways in which, you know, you're recharging the battery in that process, whereas you have all these trucks that might run away that are sort of battling those hills to try to keep their brakes solid, etc. There's another component to all this that I haven't figured out how it weighs on costs, but if a truck is able to go sort of into the mountains and average 60 or 65 miles an hour, while another truck is averaging 45 miles an hour because of the difference in capabilities, the diesels are running slower. Let's say on a hour-long run, or on a 100-mile run, in theory, the Tesla Semi goes 65 miles while the regular diesel goes 45. Now, the question that pops up is if this is a 2 or 3 hour run through the mountains, let's say in Colorado or even in California in some places, that run is large enough where the driver's number of hours drops by at least an hour, maybe two. And again, this is a good deal because the driver's there. Perhaps you're using less fuel, but I think it's kind of hard to figure out how to monetize that, because if the driver's out there for less than an hour, he still gets paid. Perhaps, you know, what else could you do with that time to add value that's unique relative to the speed that the vehicle can carry? So I was kind of fascinated by all of this because I was stunned to see Elon present carefully what these cost per mile numbers were, and that I thought that it might jeopardize some of the sort of buyership post the first blast of buyers. But again, watching the response of all customers that have had a shot at it, one would have to say that, you know, this is an excellent situation for Tesla in terms of sales. But are those sales jeopardized by the fact that the gap may not be as large as advertised? You know, I think that sort of covers it for today in terms of my thought process. The one other thing that actually does come to mind is just the fact that Tesla has an ongoing process where each year the target is to do a 5% form factor improvement of the batteries. We just are reaching the one-year anniversary of sort of the start of production of the 2170 battery. And so therefore, one would think that we're in the first tranche of that upgrade occurring. What I'm actually intrigued by is as we head 1.5, 2 years out before the trucks arrive, do we now have functionalities, perhaps longer length, less weight, or something of that fashion that further sort of makes this an excellent option when it comes for people to think about? What are your thoughts on this? Do you think folks will still be buying in large quantities despite the less than amazing cost gaps that Elon Musk talked about? You know, we could even look at the insurance piece, which is once the numbers are out there, there may be less insurance based on the fact that vehicles are no longer running into the back of other cars, et cetera, given that they have more control with the brakes, et cetera. So this will be interesting to sort of follow through on how it works. Again, this is Greg for Tesla Fan Insight. Please like and subscribe. Tschüss, macht's gut. Au revoir, la Heathrow.